a situation. I've got a video I'm going to start with this morning. I haven't got the audio stuff upgraded over here yet, so I'm going to sneak over here and hold the microphone down there. But this video will give you a sense about what we're going to be talking about this morning. So this morning we're going to talk about this idea that you cannot afford poor stewardship. We started to build on this last week, and we talked last week about, not just the money aspect, but the talents that we have, the gifts that we have, things that we're supposed to be using in service. And today we're going to focus specifically on this idea of money. Let's pray real quick, and then we're going to dive into the Word of God here. And as you can see, the scripture is up there if you want to go ahead and turn to it and get ready. We'll be looking at that in just a few minutes, but let's pray first. Father, you know, God, that I don't like talking about money, but we're going to try to tackle it here briefly this morning. God, I pray that you would speak, that the words that come from my mouth are not human words, but they are the words directly from your heart, God.
Amen.
Father, we pray that as a congregation, that we would not just tune out this whole thing of money, because, God, there's so much that we still need to do. But, Lord, we just again pray that you would guide us in your wisdom and that you would lead us according to your will in this idea of money. Father, speak clearly in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all remember who Flip Wilson? Flip Wilson was a comedian several years ago. I know all the young people are going, "Man, never heard of him." Flip Wilson was a comedian, and he used to do a skit. He was the preacher at a church called What's Happening Now Church. And in this skit, he would do this. He'd yell, "If this church is going to serve God, it's got to get down on its knees and crawl." And then the audience, being prompted, would act like the congregation, and they would all yell, "Make it crawl, preacher, make it crawl." So then he would yell, "And if this church has learned to crawl, then it's got to get up on its feet and it's got to walk. And again, the crowd would yell, well, make it walk, preacher, make it walk. And then he would say, and once this church has learned to walk, it's got to learn to run. And the crowd would yell, make it run, preacher, make it run. And then he would yell, in order to run, you've got to reach down deep in your pockets and learn to give. And the crowd would be silent. And then they would say, make it crawl, preacher, make it crawl. You know, that little skit that he did pretty much summarizes the attitude of a lot of churches and a lot of people when it comes to the idea of giving.
We want to grow.
We want to move. We want to make a difference. Just don't ask me for my money to do it. That's a pretty common attitude, isn't it? I think a lot of times we've become content crawling when God has called us to run. So we're going to keep talking about this idea of giving. And again, we started talking about it last week, with the giving of our talents and our time. But today we're going to talk about this idea that you can't afford poor stewardship. Because an attitude like that of the skit, it just doesn't work. It's not the attitude that God has called us to. As you see, our text this morning is Luke 12, 13 to 21. And hopefully you're there. And we're going to just read through this together. Luke 12, 13 to 21. Someone in the crowd said to him, teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. Jesus replied, man, who appointed me as a judge or an arbiter between you? Then he said to them, watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man produced a good crop.
He thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, this is what I will do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store all my grain and all my goods.
And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of good things laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.
But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then what will you get? Then who will get, what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with anyone who stores up things for himself, but is not rich toward God.
Now, I'm not going to walk through and do an exegetical sermon. I'm not going to walk through this and break down each verse individually.
But inside of this passage, I see three key attitudes that are a result of poor stewardship presented here.
And those are what I want to share with you this morning. The first one is this. Poor stewardship leads to bondage to possessions.
I mean, if you go back to the first part of what we read and you notice the situation, there was a brotherly dispute going on here.
Now, if you know much about the culture at that time, the oldest son was the one who got the bulk of the inheritance. He pretty much assumed the role of the father when the father was passed on or when he could no longer fulfill his responsibilities. The oldest son would get the bulk of the inheritance. And it seems to be an issue between two brothers. Because it would seem the youngest, or younger brother, I'm the youngest brother, so I got the least in my family, I guess. But one of the younger brothers is having a problem with this. And he's going to Jesus and saying, Jesus, tell him to divide the inheritance with me. Basically saying, Jesus, tell him I need a bigger cut. How am I supposed to survive on this little bit that I've got? I need a bigger cut of the inheritance. So we have a cultural thing going on here. Now, we're not given a specific reason, but we're led to believe maybe that this is the situation going on here. It's something similar to this. What we see is this idea that money is creating this chasm between these two brothers.
They go to Jesus,
and they address Jesus as the teacher.
They want him to handle the situation.
And this, again, was customary for the day because a rabbi would have also been called a teacher. And since Jesus had so many followers, they referred to him as rabbi. So it would be customary for somebody having a dispute to seek the guidance of the rabbi in helping to resolve the situation. So Jesus, being the rabbi that he was, the brothers go to him. And they look to Jesus for a resolution. Now, what strikes me here is that Jesus doesn't give them the resolution I think they're looking for.
Jesus doesn't say, you know, let's sit down and talk about this
and let's figure out who has what and let's divide this up nicely so that everybody can go away happy and you can all feel nice. That's kind of the role of arbitration today, isn't it? How can everybody win and go home happy? Jesus doesn't do that at all. Matter of fact, Jesus doesn't even address really the concern that the younger brother has. Jesus looks right past the situation and he sees the heart of the problem. And the heart of the problem was this. It was possessions. It was money. This is what was creating the issue. It's this whole idea of material wealth that was dividing this family. I mean, look back at verse 15 again. Then he said to them, watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. And it would appear that Jesus immediately recognizes that that is the heart of the matter. And it sounds just like our culture today, doesn't it? What Jesus teaches is countercultural. Not only then, but today. Because in our world,
what we have defines us, doesn't it?
Your value doesn't lie in what you own. Your value doesn't lie in what you possess. It doesn't lie in what you drive.
I love watching those BMW commercials
and Mercedes commercials. You know, they crack me up. I got a Chevy. And it works just fine for me. It's not a status symbol. It's a mode of transportation, right? Point A to point B. But see, the problem is we've allowed our world to convince us. You know, if you just have the right thing, you know, I'm getting some hair, as you can tell. And sometimes I watch those Head and Shoulders commercials with Troy Polamalu, you know, where every time he washes, his hair gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And I'm thinking, man, that would be so cool, if only it was true, right?
I don't get hair like that. I'm goofy enough with this. But
it's like our world just keeps trying to tell us that all these things can define you. All these things can make you happy. All these things can make you feel better about you. And the truth is that's all a lie.
It's a lie. It's one of the greatest lies that Satan
has perpetrated against mankind, and it's been around from the beginning, that if you just had more, then somehow, some way, you would be happy.
But it's all a lie when you give those possessions value.
Does God really value our stuff? No. What does he value? Us. That's the truth. So poor stewardship leads to bondage to possessions. See, the world gives us this mentality that we just can't live without certain things, but the reality is we can live without anything as long as we trust in God to provide what we need.
I have a lot more than I need. I admit that.
Our possessions don't give us value. They don't create a certain level of stature for us. They don't make us what we are. Bondage to possession leads to bondage of the lie. And you know what the other lie Satan tells us is? Not only will these things bring us happiness, but the other lie he convinces us of is this is mine. This is mine. It ain't yours. You can't have it. You can't touch it. I earned this. I deserve this. I heard somebody say that just this last week. They were upset and frustrated about a bad situation. They're like, don't I deserve to be happy? Apparently not. I don't know. You'd be happy if your happiness is defined in Christ. See, we convince ourselves that the things that we work so hard for, that they're ours. And we hold on to those possessions with everything we have. You can't take this from me. But see, bondage to that lie really is bondage to the father of lies. Because when we have an attitude like that, when we define ourselves in possessions, and we allow those possessions to have control over us, then Satan is really the one who has control over us. Because we're buying his lies, we're not buying the truth of God. We become his handiwork then. We cease to fulfill the purpose that God has called us to when we're trying to fulfill the purposes of the world or of possessions. Isn't that the very reason that Satan was cast out of heaven? We talked about this a little bit in Sunday school this morning. Because he wanted to be the boss. He wanted to be in control. He wanted everything to be his. Sounds like our world. It's what the Bible calls selfish ambition in Philippians 2, which the Hebrew kids have just been studying. It says we should do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. We've got to give all that up so that we can be the image of Christ. Jared Acock said it this way. He said, after I've been tithing a year or more, through no fault of mine or my family, but through sickness, we got into rather deep debt. Now the enemy said to me, you know, it's not right for you to give away a tenth of what you have to the church when you owe all these bills, because a good Christian pays his debts. So you should pay these creditors, and then when you've paid off all your obligations and you've settled all your accounts, then you'll be able to give more than a tenth to the church. He said, you know, that sounded very religious. In fact, it sounded like such a good thing that I took that advice. But that advice was wrong. And this is what is wrong with it. A Christian should pay his debts, but he should not use God's money to pay them. He should use his own.
Amen.
See, it's easy to fall for the lies of Satan, especially about poor tithing. And you know, again, I don't like preaching on tithing and on giving, but you know, this is a reality. Satan drives it home that, you know what, you earned that money. Why should you give God any of that money? Well, it's because of God math. And I've shared this with some people in the past. It's all about God math. My brother-in-law and my sister, they shared this story with me. My brother-in-law was a critical care nurse, and he had more kids than anybody he worked with, and he had more bills than pretty much anybody else he worked with. And although they were all making the same amount of money, he had a better lifestyle than everybody else at work. And they were always telling him, how can you afford to do this? How can you afford to do that? How can you afford to buy these things for your kids? And he said, simple. 90 is greater than 100. Because 90% with God's blessing will get me a whole lot farther than 100% without.
Amen.
And that's the truth. Jesus knew when he said verse 15 here, when he talked to this group, he knew that Satan had deceived our hearts. He knew that our world was buying into this idea that we don't really have to give because it's ours. And he addresses that issue here. Now, the second reason why we can't afford poor stewardship is poor stewardship leads to a distorted sense of value. Think about this for a minute. When we have more stuff, when we have more money, don't we tend to think of ourselves as better than other people? So I watch that show Top Gear. Didn't you watch that? It's on History Channel. It's these three guys that they get different vehicles and they test these vehicles. And man, they drive some really sweet cars. I mean, I really shouldn't watch that show because it causes me to stumble. Because I look at some of those cars and go, I want that. That would be cool. But they have a new commercial for the upcoming season. And one of the guys says, you know, some people think that if somebody drives a better car than you, then they're better than you. And those guys would be right. You see that mentality? It creates that distorted sense of value. Well, I drive a brand new this or a brand new that, so I'm better than you with your lowly Chevrolet. You know? Yeah. We get this distorted sense of value. It reminds me of a story. Crowded gas station. This place was packed. And there was a brand new clerk working behind the counter. And she was just finishing her training. She really wasn't very good. There was this huge line. Well, this guy comes flying up in a brand new Mercedes diesel. He pulls up to that yellow pump right in the front. He jumps out. He slaps the thing in there. And he starts pumping the gas real quick because he's in a hurry. And he finishes pumping his gas, and he's got to go in and pay for it. This obviously was pre, you know, $5 a gallon stuff where you could actually pump gas before you paid for it. But he runs in, and he gets in line, and he's like the sixth person in line. And he's standing there, and he's just totally impatient. He's tapping his foot. And look, he's in a hurry. I mean, he's an important guy. And he's waiting on all these slow people in front of him. And he finally gets up to the counter. And he looks at the woman and he's like, are you a freaking idiot? You can't ring people up? I mean, how hard is this? Why can't you just do your job? You're making me late for my meeting. Here's my money. I got to get out of here. And the lady just calmly says, sir, I might be slow and I might be an idiot, but I'm not the one that just filled up my brand new Mercedes with kerosene. See, we get this idea that somehow we're bigger and better than other people because of what we have. And it's a lie. It's a lie. You guys deal with this every day at school, don't you? Well, I have nicer clothes than you. Dude, I got the new Xbox 370 because I'm sure there'll be a new one coming out soon, right? I got the new PS4 because that'll be coming out pretty soon. You know, and everybody, oh man, you should see what I got. I am so cool, especially in high school. You know what I hate about high schoolers? Is most of them drive nicer cars than me. Doesn't that drive you nuts? 16-year-olds with nicer cars. And anyway, get off on a little soapbox thing there. But we deal with this in our culture, where everybody is saying, yeah, whatever. What I got's better. I'm more important than you. I'm more valuable than you. I'm a star football player. I can throw the ball. I'm better than you. Right? You got to deal with that all the time, don't you? That's the nature of our world. It's that distorted sense of value. They try to tell you, you know what? You're second rate because you got second rate stuff. You're second rate because your daddy don't have as much money as my daddy. I just laugh. If I had to live off my daddy's money, I'd be broke. Go out and earn your own money. Then we'll talk. You know? But they try to make you feel less valuable so that they can feel more valuable. But you know what? You are no less valuable to God. God values all of you. No matter how poor you might be. No matter how rich you might be. You know, that stuff doesn't change your value in God's eyes. We need to remember that. So where are our priorities? A group of friends went deer hunting, and they paired off in twos for the day. That night, one of the hunters returned alone, staggering under the weight of this massive 8-point buck. Well, the other guys looked at him and said, well, where's Harry? Oh, Harry had a stroke of some kind. He's a couple of miles back up the trail. You left Harry laying up on the trail and you carried the deer back? And the guy says, well, I didn't figure anybody was going to steal Harry. Trey can relate. He's watched people steal his deer and throw it in the bed of a truck and take off. He's been there. See, poor stewardship, I think, leads to a distorted sense of value. Our value comes from who we are in Christ, not what we have here on earth. And honestly, I think every one of us is guilty of wanting more than we need so that we can have some level of comfortability, if that's even a word. If not, we'll just create it. I think we're all guilty of that, aren't we? We say, yeah, I got everything I need, but man, I really would be happier if I had that. I really would live more comfortably if I had that. Which brings us to our final point. Because poor stewardship leads to a false sense of well-being. Like the rich fool in the story there. Look what I've accomplished. Look what I saved up for myself. Look what I can do. I can relax and be comfortable now. I have all these things. But it didn't work out so well for him, did it? You're going to die tonight. And you're poor in what matters. His poor stewardship cost him everything. W.A. Criswell tells of an ambitious young man who went to his pastor and told him that he wanted to promise God a tithe from his income. So the pastor prayed with him that God would bless his career. And at that time, he was making $40 a week, and he was tithing $4 a week into the offering plate. Well, in just a few years, his income had increased to the point that he was tithing $500 a week. Oh, wouldn't that be nice? So he calls his pastor and he says, Pastor, I need you to release me from this tithing thing because it's getting to be a little bit too costly for me now. So the pastor, after a few minutes of consideration, looked at the man and said, well, I don't see how you can be released from the promise, but we can pray and ask God to reduce your income back down to $40 a week, and then you'll have no problem tithing that $4. See, when we develop a false sense of well-being, we stop thanking God and we start ripping him off. Like Malachi 3 talks about. Where we start saying, well, you know, this is getting a little bit too expensive. I mean, come on now. If I got to choose between giving that extra money to the church and getting a new car and having a little extra car payment, you know, most people are going to choose the car payment, right? We start ripping God off. We start taking away what is actually his anyway, and we stop honoring him. We start bargaining. We start trying to cut a deal with God. We actually, in essence, we stop serving him at that point, and we start serving the dollar. We start serving money. The flip side of that story is illustrated here. There's a story of a missionary who asked a new convert, whose name was Pablo. He said, Pablo, if you had 100 sheep, would you give 50 of them to the Lord's work? And Pablo said, you know, I would gladly give them. Well, Pablo, if you had 50 cows, would you give 25 of them to the Lord's work? Well, of course I would. I would be more than happy to do that, came his confident reply. So once again, the missionary asked, Pablo, if you had 2 pigs, would you give one of them to the Lord's work? Well, that's not fair, Pablo said. You know I have 2 pigs. How often have we said, you know, if I only had more, I'd give more. If I only had $1 million, I would give it away. I'd get out of the way. You know, God, if you would bless me and I would win the lottery, I'd use some of that money to help people. I would do good things. Anybody else guilty of that? Just give me more, God, so I can do more. God's telling us, I don't want you to do more with more. I want you to do more with what you have now. A more honest reply came in a popular song several years ago that said, if I had $1 million, I'd be rich. That's the attitude of the world. It's all about me. So does this attitude sound like us in the church? Does it sound like us? If I only had more, then you know, God, I could afford to give. But right now, I just can't afford to give because I just got too many bills. I got too many choices that I have made that now are costing me money, so I just can't give you any of your money. Then when do we get to the point where we surrender and we start tithing instead of embracing all these excuses and all these lies that Satan keeps throwing at us? We need to do that, don't we? You want to know why? Because poor stewardship leads to bondage to possession. It leads to a distorted sense of value. It leads to a false sense of well-being. And quite honestly, like the rich man in the story, we cannot afford poor stewardship. There was a story. It was called His One Mistake, and it went like this. He brushed his teeth twice a day. The doctor examined him twice a year. He wore boots when it rained. He slept with the windows open. He stuck to a diet of plenty of fruits and vegetables. He golfed. He got at least 8 hours of sleep every night. He never smoked. He never drank. He never lost his temper. And he exercised every day. He was all set to live to be 100. His funeral is Wednesday. He died at the age of 63. He is survived by 18 specialists, 4 health institutions, 6 gymnasiums, and numerous manufacturers of health foods and drugs. He remembered everything, but he forgot God. He lived as if the world was all there was. And now, he's among those who will hear Jeremiah 8:20. The harvest is past, the summer has ended, and we are not saved. See, it's a dangerous thing to forget the spiritual side of this, isn't it? And it's really easy to do. This is something that I shared with Butch and I shared with the CIY kids when we were in California. And God was convicting me of that. He called me to pastor this church alongside of Butch, and he called me to put the focus on the spiritual, and I was working so much doing side work trying to pay bills that I wasn't focused on the right thing. And when we were in California, in the middle of one of our youth group sessions where we were learning, Denise was actually teaching, God told me, your focus is still in the wrong area. You're still focused on the money and not on the spiritual. God, quit doing something. Other than working up here, obviously, working with Daniel, trying to get some work done here. Because the focus has to be on the spiritual. And I'm saying that not because I'm telling you to go out and focus everything on the spiritual, but I'm trying to show you that even somebody like me who has been trained in Bible and taught how to preach, and someone who wants to deliver the Word of God and has a heart that tries to chase after God every day, even I can miss the point. I do it a lot, actually. And God has to remind me, and He has to remind you and all of us that our focus has to be right. Because wherever we focus is where we go. And if we focus after money, then that's what we're worshiping, and that's where we're going, is after money. God convicted me, and maybe He's convicting you this morning. I don't know. But you can't neglect the spiritual. Because quite honestly, you can chase money all day long, but in the end, the money is going to cost you everything. So have we become so focused on material that we have forgotten to focus on spiritual? I want to challenge all of you to spend some time today thinking about that, to evaluate where you are in this spiritual journey, and if your focus is where it should be or not. And then next week, we're going to talk about this idea, why does God love a cheerful giver? Sounds like a crazy thing, doesn't it? Why does God love a cheerful giver? The last thing I want to do is guilt you into giving. I want you to give because your heart is so full of joy over everything that God has done for you and everything that God has given you that you can't help but say, take it. It's yours. We're going to talk about that next week. But until then, we've got to consider, are we exercising poor stewardship? Or are we giving God what is His and trusting Him to provide our needs? Let's pray. Father, I stand up here preaching at myself. God, I know all of us wrestle with different areas, and for some of us, this whole idea of stewardship is an area that is a tough area. It's an area where we are constantly looking at our bills and saying it just doesn't work. But God, I speak from my own experience in life that when I trust You, it always works. So I pray, God, that this morning You were glorified through this message. I pray that Your word was delivered. But more importantly, God, I pray that our hearts might be softened to the reality that if we're not giving You what is already Yours, if we're not exercising stewardship and exercising tithing the way that You've called us to, that really we're ripping You off and we're worshiping money instead. And I know that's tough to hear, and I know, God, it's tough for me to say, but God, it's the truth that You present in Your word. We cannot serve both God and money. And God, I want to worship You. And I believe these people here in this group this morning, in this congregation, I believe that they all want to worship You too. So that's why we come to You right now, God. To commit. And maybe we haven't given enough, or maybe we've been selfish with what You've blessed us with. Whatever it is, God, we want to be in line with Your will, and we want to be like Christ, who gave everything. Father, guide us this week on our journey, on this adventure of the Christian faith. We ask this in Jesus' name. All God's people say. Amen. Well,